Funding for Beyond the Bully has been provided in part by Girard Academy. For over 40 years, Girard Academy has been strengthening lives, families, and communities through our cornerstone values of honesty, responsibility, courage, care, and concern. Girard Academy is a proud sponsor of KSMQ programming and Beyond the Bully. Brought to you also in part by John and Marcia Bouquet and Bouquet Company's Premier Rentals. Additional support is provided by the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund and by the members of KSMQ Public Television.
Bullying affects the victim, the bully themselves, and bystanders.
Bullying is not just physical. It could be isolation. It could be excluding someone or spreading a rumor about someone.
It just seems like you think you're too good for us these days.
Not good enough.
That's not true.
Some kids come with a lot of baggage. It takes a long time to address issues of bullying. We don't see change right away, but we attempt to build relationships, and those relationships are key in helping us really move that kid forward.
We hear a lot about bullying in the media these days, from tragic stories about bullying that have led to suicide or school violence, to cyberbullying, lawsuits over bullying. There are some who even want to make bullying a crime. An estimated 1.6 million children in grades 6 through 10 are being bullied each week in the U.S. One study reported roughly one-third of school children are involved in bullying, either being bullied or by being the bully. It's a complex problem with no easy answers. But for the next hour, we're going to take the conversation beyond the bully, talk clearly about what it is and what some here in southern Minnesota are doing to make an impact. This is Beyond the Bully.
It's like our repeated bad behavior that can happen over time, or that it's not just like, you know, someone pushes you one day, it's like they push you every day.
It just hurts people. It just hurts their feelings. It hurts their body.
Bullying is not a good choice. It hurts people and it makes them feel sad, and then it makes them feel left out.
You look at her face and stuff, and it's like, you know, you don't see the pain she must have had inside.
Rachel was bullied in school for about a year.
She's just a very colorful character.
Sweet baby Rachel, we always called her.
She was 13 years old. It still breaks my heart because I can think about her sitting there, and she tried to bulb it off, you know. She's like, oh, it's okay, Dad. I'm fine, or whatever. And
she wasn't fine.
She wasn't, no.
We didn't know Rachel was having suicidal thoughts.
And she loved dressing up and holidays and just being a kid, I guess. These are the kind of things that we have to live with now, and you know, these are the memories that we get to keep.
Her locker was vandalized, and all these stuff was written over it, and gum smeared all over her books and things, and she just couldn't understand why it would happen to her, I guess, because she wasn't that kind of kid. She wasn't a fighter, she wasn't, you know, they ganged up her that one time in a locker room kind of a thing, and she just wasn't that kind of person. We went and talked to the school officials, things like that.
I think each situation is unique between the bully and the one that's being bullied. Because now I think back with Rachel, you know, we always said, just ignore, just leave him alone, and she did. And I wish sometimes I could have gone back with my advice and said, you know, do what you need to do.
Even though I hold her in my heart, I wanted to be able to look at her. And so I put her on my arm and Jacob's ladder with the angels going up, taking her up to heaven. I think we kind of failed her in a way, because instead of helping her, it did get worse. The bullies only got emboldened and stepped it up. And so then Ray's way of trying to deal with it was to not tell us. Her famous words were, I'm fine. She would always say that, right?
Yeah.
This is the first wrap I did with some of Rachel's artwork on it. You've got the big guy and the little guy, and they all get along. All she said to me that night was, Dad, I need 30 minutes to finish some homework. And I said, okay, go ahead, and I'll come get you when I'm done. And
And I come to get her, and she had taken her life, and it was changed our lives and everybody's life forever. Yeah, it's our little sweetheart, sweet baby Ray.
So I was, you know, angry at, well, everybody, I guess, and it's not gonna bring her back anyways. I think it makes it harder knowing that a lot of it had to do with how people made her feel.
We can't go back and change what happened to Rachel, but you know, if what's going on now can help, you know, any other kids out there that are going through the whole thing, then, you know, maybe that's what Rachel's whole purpose was.
A lot of good came out of her, passing, and helped a lot of people, brought a lot of attention to the problem.
If anybody would have known that Rachel would take her life, I mean, these kids got to live with it for the rest of their lives.
She left a big impact on a lot of people's lives. And I just wish that she saw that and not all the bad things that people said about her, because they weren't true.
We're here at the Boys and Girls Club in Rochester, Minnesota, taking a closer look at the issue surrounding bullying. And joining me now is a professor at St. Joseph's University in Philadelphia, Dr. Sally Kirkendall. Dr. Kirkendall is a noted expert in youth violence prevention programs, especially bullying, and she has written a book called Bullying. And we want to thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
So let's just start right at the beginning, because I think so many people confuse the word with other things. What is bullying?
Bullying is intentionally harmful actions by one or more persons against one other person.
So it's not just someone's opinion being different. There's a very defined description for what bullying
is. It has to be intentional. Mm-hmm. So if something happens unintentionally and someone gets hurt, that's not bullying. That doesn't meet the definition. Underlying the definition is an imbalance of power where the bully has greater power than the victim.
So what exactly is an imbalance of power? Is somebody being forced to be submissive, or what does it exactly mean?
It means that the bully has more power, so they might be a very likable, popular person, and they can influence others to do their dirty work for them, or they can make other people feel less because they are more powerful. It's someone who doesn't know how to handle their power appropriately.
So we've heard so much about it in the last couple of years. You hear it everywhere on TV, but that doesn't really mean that we know how it started.
The history of bullying and bullying prevention really started in Norway in the early 1980s, when a group of very young children committed suicide. And the Norwegian people didn't like kids committing suicide and got very serious about that and demanded that the Department of Education do something about it. And the Department of Education hired a group of researchers from University of Bergen in Norway to research bullying and to come up with some kind of program to stop bullying. And from there, it spread over into across the world and into the United States.
Why do you think it's making such an impact on culture now that it's a buzzword in our culture even?
My personal opinion is that it has to do with our social connections and with mobility and changes in our society. Mm-hmm. People are moving around and there's not the social connections that would once have protected people against bullying. Kids that are new to a community are at great risk for bullying.
So you said it's a change in culture. So does that include our internet culture making the change in culture, people moving? Is that a part of it as well?
Yes. When you're on the internet, you obviously have a greater social outreach, a greater social network. And cyberbullying has issues that are specific to the internet. When children are performing cyberbullying, they are not looking at their victim face to face. And what that means is that they have a potential to be more harmful and nastier than if they were actually looking at somebody's face.
So you talk about bullying as a mental health issue in the book. How does that become a mental health issue? Is it something that causes depression, suicide, all those factors are involved?
Bullying affects the victim, the bully themselves and bystanders. The victim can suffer from physical injury, also emotional depression, higher risk for substance abuse, and of course we know about the numerous suicides and homicides that have occurred as a result of bullying. The bully is at risk because bullies will continue to push the boundaries if they haven't been appropriately set for them. Right. And when they push the boundaries, then they're going to engage in substance abuse, drug use, and also higher risk sexuality. They are more likely to end up in jail when their behavior hasn't been stopped at an earlier stage. Bystanders also suffer because they experience the stress of watching someone else being hurt, and that can cause the same level of stress that we see with people who suffer from floods or fires.
Do people often talk about the bystander issue? Do they talk to bystanders who have witnessed bullying and ask them why they didn't participate? Is there a remorse for not participating in stopping the action?
There is a severe amount of guilt that bystanders experience, and that's where the bystander mental health issues come in. Bystanders are the power, they're the key for stopping bullying, because bystanders can step in and they can help the bully to self-correct their own behavior, and they protect the victim because now the victim knows that someone else cares about them enough to stand up for them.
How can you help a victim of a bully?
There's a continuum of ways that we can help. And if you are scared and don't want to step in, then what you can do is contact the victim outside of the group, outside of school or wherever the bullying is occurring, and say, I know this is wrong, I know what's happening to you, I know it's wrong, and I want you to know that I care about you. Mm-hmm. Could we spend some time together outside of the group? Bystanders who are much more self-confident can actually get in and put themselves between the victim and the bully. Friends act as an invisible protective system for the victim. So when friends step in, the bully is less likely to take action against two people. They're going for the easy victim, which is going to be one person. So when you have a friend step in and just sit near the victim or get physically in between the victim and the bully, that tends to stop the behavior.
What are the programs that people can use as resources?
There's about 25 evidence-based programs. These are programs that have been proven to work to reduce bullying and violence that's related to bullying. So these are programs that have been tested and shown that they work. The OVEIS program is one of the larger programs that's used, and the program consists of adults monitoring bullying in high-risk areas such as lunchrooms, recesses, and change of hallway, having rules against bullying and expectations of how children will behave, classroom meetings where kids will get together every week and talk about the issues in the classroom before they get out of hand or before they escalate to bullying, and just having expectations set in terms of children standing up for other children or youth standing up for youth.
There are a number of schools in Minnesota that are already using the OVEIS Bully Prevention Program. We stopped by an elementary school in the kason-mantorville School District to see how the elementary school there is dealing with bullying with something they call Comet Pride.
This is kason-mantorville Elementary School. We are a kindergarten through fourth grade building of about 800 students. So students come from Kason and from Manorville and the surrounding rural areas.
Morning!
Morning!
Good morning!
The kids get excited about it,
yep.
And it's something that they can remember to show Comet Pride when they see us, and that's what's important.
We're kind of celebrities.
When I started in the school, one of the first things that we did was we surveyed our students just to get a gauge of as far as whether or not our students were perceiving that they were being bullied. At that time, about 42% of our kids indicated that they were bullied. We sat down and we talked about the things that we could do to improve that. As a district, we looked at implementing the OVEIS Bully Prevention Program. And then along with the OVEIS Bully Prevention Program, we decided we needed a positive behavior intervention system. And so we developed our own system called Comet Pride.
Good morning, boys and girls.
Good morning, Mrs. Brown.
Make it a great day today. Work hard. Be kids of character. Can you do that for me?
Yeah.
So every week on Wednesdays, we have our Comet Pride Days, and the staff and students will wear their blue. We all have our Comet Pride t-shirts and our logo wear. And a Comet Pride lesson is taught every week within the classrooms.
Good morning, everybody.
We do it every Monday morning. We say the bully promise.
Raise your right hand for the bully promise one.
We will not bully other students.
Promise two.
We will help students who are bullied.
Good job, Miss Anderson.
We do have the Comet Pride trophy, and that gets rotated week by week, and every week it's identified which area in the school will be monitoring for Comet Pride behavior. So it could be lunchroom behavior, it could be playground behavior, it could be hallway behavior. We also have caught showing Comet Pride. And so we have orange slips of paper. Anyone in the building that's an adult can go ahead and catch someone else showing Comet Pride.
We integrate all of our programs together to support anti-bully behavior. So we want kids to understand the importance of what they can do and be kids of character. Kids of character don't bully other kids.
We do the Comet Fight song once in a while. We do the promise.
We will not bully other students.
Then there's the bully pledge, and yeah, so that's why there's no bullies here.
Everybody has common language, and everybody has a clear understanding of what's expected. We created above the line and below the line behaviors, so students knew exactly what those expectations were.
I want to start our lesson today by reviewing what bullying is.
And then we started to teach lessons that were based on character education, Comet Pride, and OVS bully prevention.
We're going to pretend like we're on a bus. And so if I were a bully on the bus, one of the things I might do, I might go up and push her. Or I might be behind her and I might flick her hair like this. Madeline, turn around and tell me in an assertive way to stop it.
Please stop. I don't like what you're doing. It's not nice.
Good.
Maddie was standing straight and tall. Her shoulders were back. And kids, what was she giving with her eyes? Eye contact. She was looking directly at the person who was bullying her. So lessons are taught, whether it's in a kindergarten classroom or up in a fourth grade classroom, on a weekly basis.
Can somebody raise their hand and tell me, what does integrity mean?
Doing what's right when nobody's looking.
Yep, choosing to do what's right even if nobody's watching. Okay, get on the island.
Okay, it's just a little bit smaller.
I hope you can all get on the island. Five.
It's typical to see conflict and at times bullying behavior. And so we work really hard to distinguish between the two. And so what is that difference between a conflict and a bullying behavior?
Matthew, what do you think? How did it go that time?
That everybody was like, they were trying to get people on before themselves.
Yeah,
and
is that
teach
being
kids,
selfish?
If you're standing there and you have witnessed bullying, you've now become a part of that situation. We need you to be above the line and really to have that courage. There's one of those character traits to really have the courage to stand up for other people. And you may not feel comfortable standing up directly to the bully. If you're not feeling safe doing that, at minimum, you need to report to an adult. That's part of the bully promise.
Hey, maybe you should grow out your hair more because you look a lot like a boy, and that's you look a lot like a boy.
Well, this is how I like it. And if you're gonna talk to me like that, just don't talk to me at all.
We have two bystanders here. When you hear Sydney bullying your friend Isabella, what would be some things that you could say to the bully? Do you have
You don't
want to
be a bystander. You want to be somebody who says, hey, in a calm, nice voice, don't be bullying. Just you guys can make up and be friends.
So instead of standing by, we want to do what? Stand up and be that upstander. And those are some examples of ways that you can do that. So standing up for a friend, nice job. Every child has a voice that we don't want them to passively be watching what's happening. They really need to do what's right, and they know what's right. Even at that kindergarten level, they understand that difference between right and wrong.
If you see bullying, you have to try to find an adult so you are a camp manager or somebody you could talk to and trust.
I think the strength of the OVS Bully Prevention Program is truly that they empower the bystander. Not to just sit by and let it happen. It also teaches kids to be assertive. If I'm being bullied, what can I say to stop this bully behavior? I don't like what you're doing. I want you to stop calling me names. or whatever the bully behavior is, but they name the bully behavior, they stop it. They know what they need to do. And I think our bully promise lays out exactly what students need to be able to do to stop bullying from happening.
It was such a community approach, and being able to move forward and take a look at a common language and having that unified curriculum, not only here in the elementary school, but up at that middle level in high school as well. So we're all working together. When we were trained in Alveus, we were training our bus drivers, we were training the athletic director, kitchen staff, and so we had our assistants here at school, teachers, and many people that were involved in the training process. So right from the get-go, it was an all-encompassing program and really wanting to see people succeed at each level.
When I first started here, I would have a lineup outside my office in the morning to report bus incidents. I probably deal with maybe one bus incident a month because our bus drivers have been empowered to know what to do in situations, and our students have built, we've really built a community on the bus.
We also here at KM Elementary have our conflict management program, and in the fall we have students that are selected that are also specially trained to be conflict managers. They're peer mediators here within our school community.
And we have a CM vest, and we walk around with clipboards, and we go at like all the younger kids' like lunch and recess, and we'll go during that, and when they have a problem, like someone stole a ball or someone's being mean, we go and we sit down with them and we work it out and we'll get both sides of the story.
So the conflict managers are able to get facts and feelings and then move from there into more of the problem solving and the solution focus. And we have about 200 conflicts per year that are resolved with a 98% success rate.
I think any bully prevention or behavior management program has to be supported by parents as well in our community. And I think they understand. We've really worked hard to educate our parents on, you know, what's the difference between a bully situation and a conflict. And we educate our students so that they can educate their parents. And I think our parents and our community wholeheartedly support the work that we're doing because they see a difference in their kids. So in 2010, 42% of our kids were indicating that they were being bullied. This fall, 2014, we had about 6% of our kids indicating bully behavior. So significantly different survey results.
We're not at a 0%. We understand that kids are growing and learning. Kids are gonna make mistakes, and we're here to support them and to help them make better choices.
And that's our job as adults, to not have an attitude of justice, but an attitude of mercy, helping them understand that we all make mistakes. But if we tell the truth and we can work on solving those mistakes and we learn from them and it doesn't happen again, then we're gonna continue to grow into quality citizens. And that's what Kids of Character do.
K-O-M-E-T-S, go Elvis!
All right. There's more than just the Elvis program out there, correct?
Yes.
Do they all work, basically?
The evidence-based programs work. That's not every program that works. What we are trying to do in health is we're trying to review the programs. And a group of researchers from University of Colorado reviewed over 600 programs to determine which ones worked and which ones did not. And out of that, they only found 20-some that worked.
Incredible.
Now, yes. So we're spending a lot of money on programs that don't work. And what we need to do is use the evidence-based programs.
What can we do to change the community to be proactive?
There's lots of things we can do. Just things like having Boys and Girls Club gives the victims places where they can go, where they can feel safe. But more importantly, we can, as adults, can act as appropriate role models, and we can stop the behaviors when we first see them occurring. So when we hear a child calling another child a name, we can just say, that's not appropriate. We can also behave the way that we want kids to behave, and that's caring for other people and not doing things that we don't want our own kids to do.
Hey, thank you, Dr. Cook and Dalton. There are a number of organizations here in Rochester that are addressing the issue of bullying. And one of them is the Boys and Girls Club. And with me is Justin Lowndes, who is the Impact Director of Culture and Leadership. right?
Character and leadership.
Character and leadership. Thanks so much for joining us. So tell us, you must get a wide range of kids to come in here that are looking for something, whether it is companionship, friendship, someplace to be after school.
We do have a couple outreach sites, but the types of kids we see range from anybody who just needs a place to come hang out to maybe kids who are really struggling at home or in their family life. Sometimes they have really good families who are really participating in club, and we really just don't know where they're at all the time. So when they come here, we deal with what they have here.
So you see a wide range of behavior. You obviously see some bullying. How does the Boys and Girls Club address that? How do you address that in programs here? Mm-hmm.
We use a system of positive language. So we start by addressing the culture of club. And that's something we talk to the kids a lot about. So establishing a positive culture where when I'm interacting with anybody, whether it's staff to kid or kid to kid, my expectation is that is a positive interaction. When there's not a positive interaction, we address it as soon as we can. We try to give them the opportunity to change that and to address it in a positive way, you know, practice, essentially. But then when it is positive, we'll make sure to get on top of that and address that also and say, hey, you were doing a fantastic job setting the culture for club.
So you get to structure them and change behavior. Do you see a lot of impact when you see change in the kids here?
Yes, but it takes a very long time. I mean, some kids come with a lot of baggage. And as I'm sure the experts have attested to, it takes a long time to address issues of bullying. And when we get into those kind of more long-lasting issues, we don't see change right away, but we have a lot of attempts to build relationships, and those relationships are key in helping us really move that kid forward.
Do you foresee changes in any programs in Boys and Girls Club to address bullying more? Or do you see any future programs that are coming down the road?
Yeah, I mentioned social and emotional learning. It's a really big push from the University of Minnesota Extension Office right now. And so we've gotten as staff of a lot of the youth serving organizations in Rochester and around the state, we've got a lot of training regarding social and emotional learning. We're looking at doing specific programs on SEL with kids, targeting the kids who are really struggling. So when they go through and they've had behaviors and they've had a major incident, they're on our radar, we've tracked it in some way, then maybe a requirement is they're a participant in this program. Often our programs are choice. So when we have a requirement, it's definitely something that they take a little bit more seriously.
Justin Lentz, thank you so much. We appreciate you talking to us.
Thank you.
Some people actually are bullies and they enjoy seeing other people being bullied also.
There was a lot of people who were thinking they were like all that and like queen of the school, and they would pick on the people who weren't as popular and weren't as outgoing and didn't like to talk to people.
Yeah, like a lot of people would pick on me because like of my teeth, because I had braces. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. And like they would pick on me because I was shy.
Yeah.
So.
You were really shy. No offense. No offense. You're one of my best friends.
Yeah,
you know I love you.
I realize
that. But now.
Here in Rochester, there's another program that addresses bullying, but this one's at the high school level. Vanja Castro is the Youth Education Program Manager for the Diversity Council in Rochester. And the council has a bunch of programs that they put into place to address bullying. One with a name that I like called SLICK, and that is Student Leaders Creating Change. And we have two of the SLICK leaders with us this afternoon. So tell us, how did this program get started?
It started with one of the co-founders, Nick McMonagle, and he was a senior at the time in high school, at Mayo High School, and he saw someone in his AP biology class getting bullied, but he noticed that nobody was standing up for it, for this person, and it just made him feel really sick in his stomach, and he thought, if I feel this bad, I wonder what it's like to be that person who's getting bullied. So he went to his principal to see if there's something they can do, create a program. Then the principal came to the superintendent, and the superintendent called me, and then we came up with this program. Because what we found in research is that to prevent or intervene bullying, it works best when students do it, when peers. And so we wanted to create a training program of bullying prevention and intervention, so students would be able to know what they could do when they see a bullying incident happen.
Do you still have any kind of hesitancy about jumping in, or is it something hard to do?
Definitely, since they're your friends, it's harder to stand up for them. But you always want to, because like Vanjie said, you don't want to regret it later and hurt the person. But I definitely get a really good feeling once I do step in and help out, so.
You got any stories or anything that you can tell us about some things that have happened to school that have gone for the better since putting the program in with SLIC?
We got the entire school to come out and listen to the stories of these students who, you know, have been bullied or have gone through something, like situations like that.
Have you seen an impact with these programs, Vanjie?
I think there was a change, more of a change with the students who went through the program and continue to be members, is that they understand what it means, the long-term effects of what bullying does to people. And so they've learned how to be more leaders in their group or in their community, and they've also learned what it takes to put on kind of like an anti-bullying campaign or try to get involved in the community and inform community members what they need to do to help prevent and stop bullying. A lot of the kids really were happy that we were there, knowing that there was somebody that was wanting to stand up and be their voice for them when they couldn't do it themselves.
What would you guys want people to understand about this program? What are the strengths of this program that people need to know?
Because it's run by the students, I think that it's more effective because we're the ones who walk in school every day. We're the ones who go to the classes and see everything that teachers don't always see. And so us being there and other kids knowing that, like Vanjie said, they may not be able to stick up for themselves, but we'll stick up for them, is really important.
I think it's given a lot of kids confidence, because with bullying, you're always scared to intervene, but after all the stuff you've learned, you're just a lot more sure of yourself and just, you know, go ahead and do what you need to do.
I always try to kind of let the kids know that kindness is what's most important. You know, anybody can be mean. Mm-hmm. It's very easy to be mean, but it takes more effort to be kind, and that as long as they can share that with their friends, it just kind of, hopefully it can create that culture and environment that doesn't accept bullying anymore. It normalizes it.
Right. Really, really, really great that you guys take part in it, and the organizations like the Diversity Council are here. So thank you guys.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Like, I sometimes tell them to, like, stop. And, like, I usually try to take, like, the person who's being bullied away because some of my friends get bullied.
A couple of my friends where they stood up for someone and then they started getting picked on. And so it just went in a circle.
This little kid walked past, I never talked to him before. And all of a sudden, I stopped him. I told him, hey, I asked every little kid how was school. And all of a sudden, he told me that he got picked on. I'm like, why did you get picked on? He was like, I don't know. I'm like, really? And I was like, you know what you could do? You go up and tell the teacher and see what she said. If she don't say anything and they stay bullying you, you go to your parents and tell them.
In 2013, a group of kids from middle school to college took a unique approach to bullying. They addressed it head on, front and center, on stage. And it became known as a program called AWARE.
So, why don't you tell me about your report card?
We created a series of vignettes based on different types of bullying. And in the end, we called it AWARE. We decided to do it as a joint project between the Civic Theater and the college. We had students in it everywhere from junior high up through college.
You are failing.
Failing.
I did not fail anything.
The students were involved in all aspects of this. We started out with listening to them. What have you experienced? What have you heard? What have you seen? What made you feel bad? And we took those stories first, and then we gave them assignments. And they had to go out and research and come back with actual research dealing with bullying and ideas of how people can cope with bullying. From that point, we got creative.
Sam,
Johnson.
Oh my.
Our hope is that we can find an entertaining way to make teens more aware of really what's happening when they are bullying.
Hey, how's it going?
No,
just look at me.
This time I'm not gonna listen. I'm not gonna listen to you because it's not worth it.
Drama.
Hey, I think I might like Luke, but don't tell anyone, okay?
Uh-huh. Mary totally wants Luke.
Mary wants Luke.
Hashtag I don't care. Hey. Did you get my text?
No.
Oh. Mary wants Luke.
Oh. Hey, dude.
Yeah?
Mary totally wants you. Go get him, Tiger. I mean, you know what they say. One door closes, another door opens.
Dude, Mary wants Luke. For real?
Yeah.
Yo, Mary wants Luke.
Slut?
And this is just one of many vignettes that are part of the AWARE project. And joining us now is one of its co-directors, who is Denise Rimping, who is also the education director at Rochester Civic Theater. Thanks so much for being here. Let me ask you just right away, how does a project like this with so many kids and so many various backgrounds, how does this get started?
In the last few years, we've had a lot of kids in the area who've committed suicide because of bullying, and some of them were friends of my students, and that strikes a little too close to home. So I had the idea of creating something around bullying, and then talking to Jerry Casper, who is the theater director at the Rochester Community and Technical College. He also had an idea to do a bullying project as well. And we had very specific students in mind as far as who we thought would work well in this project. Kids who were not only creative and very talented, but also would be able to handle such a delicate subject matter and sensitive topics.
How do you get the kids to really give content? And can you even edit that?
Well, it wasn't easy. I mean, we had a huge list of things, topics we wanted to talk about, and as anybody who's involved in an artistic project like this will tell you, it's what we had that we felt the strongest about and what we felt would have the most impact. We did a lot of playing around, we did a lot of improv. We found things that we really felt connected to, and we really felt, wow, this is going to have a strong impact, or clearly, this is a well-developed idea. We should delve into it further.
So vignettes this powerful can't help but transform people, even in the cast. So did you see any changes in any of the young men and women that were involved with the AWARE project?
Absolutely. I think, right away, just having them out there talking to people that they were going to school with, their peers, their teachers, I think had a significant impact on them right away, seeing the subject from different angles and different viewpoints. And like I said, we spent a lot of time talking about things, and there was a lot of stuff that was shared in those sessions, and there were tears that were shed, and I think there were a lot of eye-opening experiences for a lot of them. And I know that many of them said, when this was all said and done, that, their perspective on it had changed, that they were more aware of what was going on, and they would definitely be more sensitive to those around them. For example, one of the things that we discussed, and we were really bringing it out this year more so than we did last year, is the idea that even bullies can be victims too, and that there are different reasons why people bully, and it's not necessarily because they're just mean, right, evil people.
Right, it was learned. It was something that was being done to them. They're transferring it.
Right, but to be sensitive that every person is different and every person's experience is different, and that we don't always know what's going on in their life, and I'm kind of opening up our eyes to other people's perspectives.
Denise Rimping, co-director of AWARE, thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, thank you.
Well, you know, we wanted to find out what kids would think about these vignettes, so we invited a group from the Boys and Girls Club to watch them with us.
Things got hard to do. Things got hard to deal with, so I cut. It was a way of release for me to silently feel the pain without lashing out. I guess I was afraid of confrontation. It all started in middle school. I was shy and never really connected with a group of people. I was called a loner, a loser, a freak. I tried to ignore them, but it didn't help. I just made it worse for myself. They started rumors about me, about how I couldn't speak English or how I was mentally retarded. And none of it was true, but after that, no one wanted to talk to me. After a while, when I couldn't take it anymore, I tried to talk to one of my teachers, Mrs. Thompson. She said that girls would be girls. I was so mad that I left school early and walked home. Anger built up inside of me like a tsunami wave on the verge of crashing over. I could believe nothing, even when I got home.
I was sad, too. Confused. I'd never done anything to those girls except exist. I don't know why they want to ruin my life. When I got home, I went to the shower to shower off the bad feelings. That's what I did when I was down, but this time it didn't make me feel any better. That's when I spotted the razor. There was this ball of energy pressing on my gut. I felt like I needed to cry, but there were no tears. I made a slash in my forearm.
As the blood flowed out of me, so did my anger. In place of it, I felt pain, but at least I was able to cry about anything other than my middle school tormentors. I felt as if I'd found a fix. But it didn't fix anything.
When I was the last to be picked on a team, when I heard whispers about me in the hall, when I was called terrible things to my face, I waited until I got home to my razor. I never cut too deep to do any real damage. But scars did form. And you know what? I was proud of them. I thought of each of them as a battle won, another day survived in a pit of snakes, all who wanted to strangle the life out of me.
I knew cutting was bad, but I never thought it was a big deal until my mother, on the one day she came home from work early, caught me in the act. She was surprised, and then she got all teary-eyed, and she asked me a million questions. My heart was beating fast, and I was scared to tell her why I did it, afraid she'd be mad. So I said nothing at all, and then she sent me to a shrink.
When I got there, I just sat with my arms crossed and my lips sealed. I wasn't about to reveal myself to some stranger. She told me that she cared and that she would try and understand, but I wasn't gonna fall for it. Nobody understood. Nobody cared enough to try and understand. I wasn't gonna let someone else try and help me when I was too afraid to help myself. That tsunami in me was rising again, but this time it wasn't just on the verge of crashing over, it was on the verge of utter destruction.
When I got home, I sat in that uncomfortable chair. I gave away nothing. I knew that when I got home and my nervous mother went back to work to make up for my dead father's income, my razor would be waiting for me like the friend I never had, ready to console me and tell me that everything was going to be okay. Except for when I took my friend to my arm, my hands were shaking too much. I cut too deep.
Blood flowed to the tile floor.
Too much blood.
I smiled, though, unknowing.
I could only see all my emotions spilling out of me, gushing out until I felt and saw nothing at all.
Okay. That was pretty deep. What did you guys, did you see anything in there that you recognized, or if you see, hear a friend like this or see a friend like this, what do you do to try to make it better for them? What do you do to try to offer them so to let them know that there's another way?
I'm giving them the number to the hotline teen help.
Are there places for kids to go?
Yeah. There are suicide hotlines.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've seen.
Yeah. What did you guys think about that scene though?
Intense.
Yeah.
But it's pretty much speaks the truth of how like most cutters feel, cause like every now and then I'll see cuts on someone's leg or on their arm. Like I know a few people that have cut before.
Mhm. Why did they say that they did it? Was it like what you heard?
Cut of bullying.
Mhm. And did they say that they felt it was like a release?
Most of the people that I know said that it like releases their pain, it like gives them the feeling that they suffer was worth it.
When you see something like this, does that look like bullying to you, or do you think that that's something different?
Sometimes people can cut not only for bullying, but like hardship, what's going on at home, yeah. What happened to family, a family member dying. Or sometimes, like, even just for a little bit of attention.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because I have some friends who do cut themselves. Mm-hmm. And I've talked them out of suicide a few times as well. Mm-hmm. And it's hard. Mm-hmm. And, like, I always have to tell them, I'm here for you, and I'll understand the best I can.
Mm-hmm. It's got to be something that you wrestle with, and again, it goes back to, who do you tell? Do you tell somebody or not?
Maybe 3 weeks ago, one of my friends gave us like a note they were gonna leave for suicide, and we took it to the counselor.
Do people get mad? I mean, would they get mad at you?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've lost a few friends because I've told someone.
Really?
I realize that bullies just like to do just for fun, and maybe they're being bullied by their parents, by someone else, or just do it for the heck of it.
It's kind of hard if your friend tell you don't tell no one, not to tell no one, but sometimes you gotta stand up to be the bigger person and go tell someone and let them know what's going on and have them solve the problem. And your friend probably be mad at you a couple of days, but the best thing to do is go tell someone.
Yeah.
At school, at recess, a lot of people get bullied, and a lot of people like to say that I'm gonna commit suicide, so just say goodbye because I'm not coming back to school tomorrow. And I say you shouldn't really do that, and I said just calm down, take a deep breath, and we talk to the counselor and the principal. And then we just meet and talk about it.
Thanks, guys. You wanna watch another one?
Sure.
Let's watch one more.
The following piece you're about to see may startle you, for it would not be possible to portray the stunning effects of this certain lifestyle choice otherwise. Now, although these characters are fictionalized for the purpose of the story, they are based on actual research pertaining to the effects of this certain lifestyle choice on young people's lives.
Hey, Paul!
Hey, Jan, what's up?
So, have you heard about the new kid?
Yeah, he was in my lit class this morning. Seems like a swell guy.
That's not what I heard.
Why? What did you hear?
I heard that he was different.
Different? As in,
You know, different.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow, that's kind of...
disgusting.
Well, yeah, but, are you sure?
Yeah, apparently he made some comment in the locker room this morning at PE.
Ew, in the locker room? Of all the places. That's rather inappropriate, don't you think? I mean, right there where everyone changes?
I know, right? So gross.
What did he say exactly?
Oh, get this. They were talking about the homecoming dance and the new kid wants to bring... Sam Johnson.
Oh my, this is
I can't.
I know. I can't believe it either.
Is the school even going to allow that?
Oh, geez, I hope not. Can you imagine?
I don't want to.
I mean, they'd be like slow dancing and stuff.
I just can't. Stop.
I mean, what if they started making out?
No, stop it. Gross. I don't even want to think about it.
I mean, what they do in their own personal time is their business. But to flaunt around in public like that?
Exactly. Is that so much to ask? Just keep it to yourself.
It's really an assault on our personal choices.
Exactly. I totally agree.
Oh gosh, here they come.
Oh my God.
He's got Sam with him.
Are they holding hands?
This cannot be happening. Is there a teacher around? Somebody must be stopping this.
PDA, that is blatant PDA.
Oh, they're coming, just don't look. Straight.
Jam, stop.
Readers.
Jam, stop.
Excuse me, but did you say something?
No, 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 no. That wasn't us.
Oh, really? So you didn't just suddenly call out breeders?
No, no. That must have been someone else.
You know what? Just save it. You're not worth my time. Just continue going on about your ignorant ways.
Ignorant? Excuse me? We're not the ones flaunting around our choices.
Choices?
Yeah, choices.
You mean our choice to be straight?
You know exactly what I mean.
Ron and I didn't choose to be straight any more than you chose to be gay.
Gay is the way we were born. Gay is what God made us to be. I'm sorry, but what you two are doing is just unnatural.
I can't believe this. I thought I left this behind at my other school. I'm never gonna get away from this.
Please tell me you're not actually bringing that to the homecoming dance.
Excuse me?
You're never going to allow it anyway.
Will you be bringing your girlfriend?
Of course.
Then why shouldn't I be allowed to bring mine?
Because it's disgusting.
No more disgusting than watching this one macking on his boyfriend in the hallways all day long.
Dean and I are a couple. We are in love. That is what couples do.
Well, so are me and Ron.
You're not a couple. You're an
abomination.
So why don't you get out of here, you straight,
breeding
whore?
No, Ron! They're not worth it. Let's get out of here before we get into trouble.
I can't believe you'd say that.
That's right. Walk away. Walk away and never come back.
Did you see the look on her face when you called her a whore?
And I don't want to see your faces at the dance either. You show up there and you're dead.
Oh, Paul, I didn't know you had it in you. Dean's a lucky guy, I tell ya.
No, hetero.
Sorry.
Now that you have seen Ron and Sammy ostracized by their certain lifestyle choice, now brings about a new topic, that this could happen to your child, or yours, or yours.
So what'd you guys think? A play on what you normally hear, right?
Yeah, but like the opposite, because usually people make fun of the gays, but here it's like the gays make fun of the straight. Usually it's the opposite way around.
So when this happens at school and someone says, I'm gay, what normally happens at your school or with the crowd that you guys hang out with?
A lot of people call them names and say, ew, that's disgusting.
Or like a lot of people act like it's a joke and they're like, oh, that's funny. And then they're like, oh, wait, you're serious. And they're like, yeah.
The people that you're comfortable with aren't comfortable with you being gay or transsexual, then you need to like remove yourself from that situation. Because if they can't accept you for who you are, they're not gonna accept you any other way. So then you just need to like put yourself with people that are like you and that will support you.
So let's say you guys have friends that come out. Do you guys get backlash from other people who are just like, why are you hanging out with them? Are you gay too?
All the time.
Yeah.
All the time. A couple of my best friends are actually like different sexualities, and like I have a couple of them who are bi, and then I have a couple of them who are lesbians and gays. And I think they make the best friends.
People are just judging other people, how they are, how they dress, how they look. And I think they shouldn't be doing that because they're acting like their self and they're being their selves.
Mm-hmm. So what's the option? You go to an adult, you stand up for your friend. What are all the things that you can do to help somebody who's being bullied?
No matter what happens, just be there for them because that's when they need you most.
Mm-hmm. Everybody agree?
Yeah. I think it's just the fact that like people grow up, like when you're a little kid, you start off hearing like, oh, you're gay, you're fat. Like when you start growing up, it, like, you get more sensitive to the fact that people actually are gay. So like, it's based off how you grew up, knowing that it's gay right or is it gay wrong. So pretty much based off the peers you grew up with.
Thanks, you guys. You guys did a great job. Thank you so much. We're back with Dr. Sally Kirkendall, and we just wanted to take a quick review and find out what you thought about the kids' reactions to these vignettes.
I was thrilled by their reactions. They were so mature.
They were.
And the information that they came out with was right on target.
You know, they seemed to be able to handle situations well that would really be daunting for any adult.
Yes.
Yeah. And many of them went through the proper channels that you would suggest to talk to an adult. You know, stand up, even if it means that you sacrifice some friendships, you're standing for what's right.
Yes, and calling the suicide hotline. Mm-hmm. If you are concerned about a friend or if you have issues that you're dealing with yourself.
So do you think that the theater role playing is a really good option for kids to see and understand what to do to identify with what's happening and then be able to follow up on it?
I think that it sends the message that you're not dealing with this alone, that there's other people who are dealing with similar issues, and there's people out there that, who are willing to listen. And I think that's so important for kids to remember, is that what happens in high school is just a microcosm of the universe, and that once they get out, life will be completely different.
What do you think that we can do as adults for proactive steps to teach our children about bullying?
I think we need to recognize that the child's brain is still growing, and it grows until we're about 25 years old, and maybe for some of us it continues to grow. I think we just need to remind ourselves that we need to allow kids to make mistakes, and we need to correct their behavior in respectful ways, and continue to encourage them to grow into healthy adults.
Okay, Dr. Kirkendall, thank you so much for your insight and working with us on this program.
Thank you.
We may never be able to completely eliminate bullying, but raising awareness and teaching your children about the subject is a step in the right direction. We hope you learned a bit more about how to go beyond the bully and what resources are available to help. Thanks for watching.
Funding for Beyond the Bully has been provided in part by Girard Academy. For over 40 years, Girard Academy has been strengthening lives, families, and communities through our cornerstone values of honesty, responsibility, courage, care, and concern. Girard Academy is a proud sponsor of KSMQ programming and Beyond the Bully. Brought to you also in part by John and Marcia Bouquet and Bouquet Company's Premier Rentals. Additional support is provided by the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund and by the members of KSMQ Public Television.